I'm going to show you how to make a bell in 5 minutes.
Good morning, John Taylor, about Foundry.
In a world where tradition meets technology, the ancient craft of bell making embarks on a modern journey. As with all beginnings, we start with a vision, a bell conceived not on paper, but with the digital realms of CAD.
It's where CAD gives a major advantage over, say, doing on pen and paper, as it always used to be done. It allows us to do a proper 3D model of a tower and visualise physically how that bell is going to fit in the tower.
Once the logistics and measurements are figured out, it's time to make a physical bell. This is the mould-making process, a delicate dance of sand and clay that forms the negative space, a hollow that will soon cradle molten metal.
So we start with what we call an outer mould. That creates the outside shape of the bell when we've cast it as you look at it. Cool thing with that is we are still using the original mould boxes that were made for the company when it first opened in the 1850s. We then sort of like crudely bricklay on the inside to create the shape of the bell using what we call a strickle. So that spins round and makes the like profile of the bell. And then that gets dried in the big drying oven that we're currently sat in because it's nice and warm.
With the molds set, cases put on and holes dug, the foundry alights with the glow of molten metal. The pour is both a spectacle and a solemn rite, as the fiery liquid finds its way, settling into its new shape.
So to actually do like sort of the melt side of everything, that starts with firing up the furnace. The pot inside is made of graphite. When it's cold, it's like really weak. It's like a Ming vase, but then as it heats up, it gets stronger and stronger. When everything's warmed up and it's like a sort of bright orange, we then put what we call the charges, so that's all the metal we're going to melt. We put as much of that into the furnace as we can. As it gets hotter and hotter, you keep turning the furnace up. You basically just have to keep an eye on it all day, watch the metal level slowly drop as it melts, and then when it gets to a certain point, we add more metal to it, so there's a constant supply. We'll put what we call the pouring ladle. We tip the metal into the ladle, then that gets lifted with the crane, and we do a load of like prep work to it. So we'll clean off any slag, any impurities basically, that are on the top. We scrape them off so it's just pure clean bell metal. One person driving the crane, so he controls where the ladle goes. One person that's on what we call the wheel, so they're actually in control of turning, like tipping the ladle, controlling the flow. And then I stand sort of actually in front of the mould, controlling the speed that the metal flows into the mould. And then ultimately when the mould's full, I'll feel like back pressure on the stopper rod that I'm holding, and then I have to tell Sam, stop.
As the metal cools, anticipation builds. The breaking of the mould is a rebirth, a raw bell emerging from its earthen cocoon, ready for refinement.
So the plan is we're gonna lift this entire mould out of the ground, take the now cold pouring bush off the top, and then separate the two halves of the mould. Lift the case off the top, and that should reveal the newly cast bell.
The final stage is one of care and precision. Fettling, the delicate process of cleaning and smoothing, erasing the remnants of sand and clay. So there we have it. We've witnessed the birth of a bell, each step a testament to the blend of art and craft, tradition and technology. So what's next? Tuning.
Lucky for you, we've created a whole video all about bell tuning, so don't forget to subscribe. Thank you for joining us on our journey from conception to chime. We'll see you next week for more insights into the art of bell making.